Hey, Bob. Thanks for joining us on Gemini Live today. I appreciate you coming and taking the time.
My pleasure.
All right. So I know that you are on a panel coming up on Saturday, right?
That's correct.
What time is that one?
I think we start at 10:45, go to 12:15.
Okay. It sounds like an interesting topic. Do you want to tell me a little bit about it?
Yeah. It's first of all, it gives everybody here their mandatory 1.5 MCLE units for legal ethics.
Yes.
Usually they put the ethics panel on the last day, kind of to encourage people to stay. And I told them, no, do it Saturday morning.
Right.
I want to make sure everybody's here. I do hope it's going to be interesting. Instead of just a mandatory, 1.5 units talking about X, Y, and Z in ethics, we're going to use a real example of a state bar complaint that I received.
Oh, wow.
Back in 2018. And how it kind of upended my life, and as I kind of not wind down my career, but I've been practicing 45 years.
Oh, wow.
And or so. And I wanted to, when you leave your career, you want to be on a high note. And I didn't want to be leaving with a state bar complaint against me. And so I've used that example of basically what to do when you do receive a state bar complaint. So that's how we got the title, What to Do When the State Bar Comes Knocking on Your Door.
Right.
And we also hope that we can offer some tips to avoid getting a state bar complaint. Because if you've been practicing any length of time in workers' comp, which is a volume practice,
yes,
the odds are you're going to get a state bar complaint or two from an unhappy client. And yeah, they may not have any validity to it, but you still got to do what you need to do. And I think our goal on the panel is to avoid getting a complaint, but if you do get one, how do you respond?
And if there was a complaint that was, let's say, unjustified, how much time and effort does it take to get that taken care of or expunged or however you would say it, right?
Well, it depends on the nature of the complaint. And you can get a complainant or a client, former client, set forth one allegation against you.
Yes.
In mine, the individual alleged 9 different points of malfeasance or ethical breaches. And his case had been going on for 19 years in my office. I wasn't the original attorney that handled it, but I took it over from one of my partners, and I took it very seriously, and I spent probably 40 to 50 hours preparing a response to the state bar.
Wow.
And my response was 10 pages, single-spaced, a letter with 14 exhibits attached to it. And the client who made the complaint was a very smart individual, a retired police officer for a small city. He's very intelligent, very involved in the litigation of his case, and he knew what he was doing. And he had a paper trail, and he wanted to use that paper trail. His only problem was my paper trail was as good, if not better, than his.
You're lucky it was.
So I was able to respond, and the state bar basically didn't dismiss the case, but found it unwarranted.
Yes.
And then he filed an appeal.
Okay.
And asked for reconsideration, and they reopened it. And it ultimately resolved with what they call a slap on the wrist warning to me, which did not go in my state bar profile.
Excellent.
So it's not in my file. And if anybody Googles me or goes to the state bar and puts in my bar number, they're not going to see any complaint. And that's how it ended up getting resolved.
Sure.
But it was extremely stressful to me. Very stressful.
And did you defend it all by yourself, or did you get outside counsel to help as well?
A little bit of both.
Yes.
After I prepared my response, I consulted with an attorney who specializes in state bar defense.
Yes.
Not the lady that we have on my panel. The lady on my panel, Ellen Pansky, is extremely bright, and I'm thrilled to have her on the panel. And that's all she does. But I didn't know her at the time. I was given a recommendation to another attorney. Very, very sharp, very cooperative. And he said, this complaint is not going to go anywhere, but let me review your response and let me see what changes, if any, I want to make. So after I did the rough draft, I sent it to him, and he made a couple changes, and very minor, and said, you're good to go. And I was more than willing to pay for a consultation fee. I was willing to pay for representation.
Absolutely.
If he thought I needed it. And he was very upfront. He goes, you don't need representation. You just need to do this. And I did it and followed his advice and all worked out.
Yeah. Well, so, that's great.
And that's one thing, you know, we kind of cover a little bit in the panel, you know, whether you do or do not need an attorney. It's kind of like work comp. I meet, not anymore, I don't meet with clients, but I speak with clients now and often advise them they don't need an attorney, depending on where their case is and their claim. And I try to be upfront with them and say, you can do this on your own. You're at the end stages. Just let me review your settlement documents. Kind of like what this attorney did with me.
Yes.
Let me review what you've got, and I'll tell you whether you do or do not need an attorney.
So, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah. So switching gears, COVID has upended the industry in a whole lot of different ways, right? So one of the ways is a lot of firms went to remote work or part remote work.
Right.
How did your firm deal with that side of the pandemic?
Well, I think like a lot of firms, the first couple of months was difficult to make the adjustment.
Yep.
You know, we shut down the office pretty much, and everyone was working remotely except for some secretaries, file clerks, attorneys were all sent home. The only attorneys that were working in the office were me and my two partners.
Were you set up well enough in order to work remote?
We were.
Oh, good.
We were, because we, for most of our attorneys, they're paperless.
Yes.
We retain everything, paper, and for the old people like me, even though I know what I'm doing on the computer and I can access all my documents, I'm still of that mode. I want that file in front of me.
Right.
And but most of the attorneys were able to adapt, and as COVID kind of not winded down but got better prior to Omicron,
yes,
we were bringing the attorneys back slowly. As of like October 1 of 2021, we asked our attorneys to start coming back to the office at least 3 days a week.
Okay.
Primarily to be able to interview clients, although we're still not interviewing clients, new clients, in the office. So, you know, everything is remote. Depositions are remote.
Right.
Depositions to clients and doctors are remote. And the hearings at the board, even though they were getting back to live hearings,
now they're
remote again.
Yes.
So that's really, really changed the practice. I don't want to continue the way we're doing. For the last 2 years, it hasn't been a whole lot of fun.
No.
Because I like people contact. I know a lot of applicants' attorneys, they've done their interviews for years over the phones of new clients. I don't like to do that. I always met with my new clients. I would spend a minimum of an hour with a new client face-to-face.
Oh, wow.
And I establish a relationship with the client. They learn about me, I learn about them, they come into my office, they see all my baseball memorabilia, we talk baseball, sports, Corvettes, and they know me. You don't get that on the phone.
You don't.
You get 20 minutes, 25 minutes max on the phone with a client. You don't get as much information as you normally would get in a live interview. So I miss that. I miss having people in the office. I have two full-time secretaries. One has worked remotely from home in Henderson, Nevada, and I've seen her once since February of 2020, and she's been my secretary for 40 years.
Wow.
And she's not only just my secretary, she's a close friend.
Sure.
I watch her kids grow up. I watch her go through divorce, get remarried, and she's grown up with me and my kids. So I miss that. I miss that one-to-one contact with my attorneys, with my staff. And that's made it difficult to practice law the last couple of years.
And do you think it's going to go back to what it was at some point?
No, I don't think it'll ever go back 100% to the way it was. Just like the entire industry, the business industry is changing. A lot of people don't want to work. That's one thing I don't get, is people resigning from their jobs and saying, I don't want to do this. And you go, okay, but how are you going to support yourself? So we've had people resign and just say, I don't want to work anymore. We've had three secretaries resign in the last month. Two are moving out of state. We had our two receptionists resign. I think the way it's going to go back once the virus gets somewhat controlled, and I think it will, but I think masks are the future, the indefinite future. I think part-time remote work for attorneys and staff is the future.
I agree.
But I think it'll go back a little bit to the way it was, but it'll be kind of a hybrid of what we do.
What I've also found is that the number of workers that are injured has gone down pretty dramatically over the last couple of years.
We haven't seen that.
You haven't?
No.
Okay.
And we keep pretty good numbers. We have a very good statistical system.
Yes.
We know exactly how many new clients we sign up every month. We know the nature of the case, if it's work comp, if it's personal injury, or if it's disability pension. Mm-hmm. We know we have a breakdown on who they work for. So I can tell you at the end of each month exactly how many LA City police officers, firefighters, LA County sheriffs, LA County firefighters that I signed up and that the firm signed up. So I can keep stats, and we've kept them for 35 years. And so we compare them. We know exactly where we are every month. Our cases are maybe down 5% in 2021 over what they were in 2020. But a very small decline.
Because of the niche that you're in?
A little bit. There's, you know, we have competitors in the field.
Sure.
They have their share of clients. We have our share. But overall, we have done, from a client perspective, we did as well in 2020. There was a decline in new cases in 2020 from like March of 2020 with the shutdown, probably through July.
Right.
And then we started to see the uptick in the clients coming back. 2021, back to normal.
Back to normal.
Back to normal.
2019 levels.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, good for you.
And even the first month, this month in 2022, my personal numbers are more than I want them to be, because I've been trying to make a concerted effort to reduce the number of cases that I have as I get older. I don't have any immediate plans to retire, but I just want to reduce the number of cases that I have.
Sure.
But I haven't been able to do it, especially this month. So,
are you finding that it's... Are you still looking to grow the number of attorneys in your firm, or do you think you're going to be at the number of attorneys that you're at?
We've been at this kind of number for 40 years.
Okay.
And we don't have a burning desire to be 25 attorneys. I think the lowest we've ever been was 12, and that was a long, long time ago.
Okay.
But we've always been a consistent 15, 16, 17, 18 attorneys in the firm. I think right now we're at 16 attorneys. It's a good number for us. You know, we have a large space. We've got 19,000 square feet. I don't know if we're going to need that when our lease expires again. We've been in the same building since 1993.
Oh, wow.
And we've, you know, re-upped the lease several times.
Yes.
And the last one was about 3.5 years ago. So we have about two and a half years left on this lease. And it'll be interesting to see, do we need all that office space? If you have attorneys that are working 3 days a week in the office, they don't necessarily need their own office.
No.
And I think that's where a lot of firms, a lot of law firms, not just in work comp, are going. So, yeah, we want to kind of stay where we're at. Having more isn't necessarily better.
No, and I think a lot of law firms have found that over time and done the... expansion and contraction.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Game.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And the overhead is, you know, gets to be outrageous.
Yes.
You know, we're a very generous firm for our attorneys. We have full medical that we pay for. We have the, you know, retirement plans that we contribute to for them. And we've always been a generous law firm in that regard, but it's expensive.
Yes.
You know,
absolutely.
So more, like I said, more is not necessarily better.
Well, I appreciate you taking the time with me today. Continued success.
Thank you.
All right, and have
a
great show.
Thank you. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.